Welcome to Chasing Fabulous, the show where we embark on a glamorous adventure to uncover the secrets of true fabulousness. Join us as we explore the world of luxury, style, and sophistication, seeking out the people, places, and experiences that define what it means to live a truly fabulous life. Get ready to be captivated as we chase down the essence of fabulousness in every episode of this exhilarating journey. Every corner, every shadow, every light holds a story, a chance to discover something fabulous.
Hey, welcome everybody. This is our third show, Linda.
I know.
Our third show of Chasing Fabulous. I'm Monica. And there's Linda.
Here we
Listen,
are.
Linda.
Here.
Oh my gosh. So last week's show was so much fun, right?
Oh my God.
Oh my gosh.
It was so
much fun. The karaoke show and talking about the ladies
and the lyrics.
Oh, the lyrics. So much fun.
Do you know that everybody's been asking me afterwards, what about this song? What about this song?
Yes.
I'm like, I know we couldn't put them all in, but there are so many.
There's so many songs. And then this past week, we had Studio 54 night at karaoke on Mondays at Domenico's. And oh my gosh, we'll put our pictures up on Facebook of me and Linda, what we wore for Studio 54. We decorated too. We did the decorating. I did my feather arrangements. Anybody that knows me knows what the feather arrangements are. So those were really fun. And everybody blinged out like crazy. It was a really fun night.
It was fabulous.
Yeah. So every...
I had to say it.
It's almost like the first Monday, either the first Monday or the second Monday.
I think it's the second Monday.
The second Monday of every month we have a... Curtis has a theme. So next month's theme is
luau.
Oh, luau.
Hawaiian luau.
Yeah. So the grass skirts.
Grass skirts, coconuts.
Yes. Put the lime in the coconut.
Yes.
And I'm going to decorate because I have an entire storage space full of freaking luau.
What a surprise.
Stuff.
What a surprise.
I know. It's shocking.
I'm shocked right now.
So what did you do last week? Linda went to
BTO concert, Bachman Turner Overdrive.
Oh
my goodness. First of all, we went to Westbury Music Fair, and every seat there, you've been there, right?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Every seat there is a great seat because the stage turns.
Right.
And the interesting thing about it, I didn't even realize this because I said to Mark, when we first sat down, we were like in the fifth row. I was like, oh my God, I'm in the fifth row.
Gosh.
I was so excited. But they were facing the other way, and I'm like, does the stage turn? And it just slowly... And before you know it, they're right in front of you. I mean, not that it matters because they're just unbelievable.
I like that venue. It's not $4 million to go there. I think I saw Hootie there a couple times. I saw Dave. I don't know who else I saw there. Maybe Rob Thomas I saw there.
Oh, my God.
But it's good because every seat is nice.
Every seat is nice. And let me tell you something. They've rocked the place. Randy Bachman was part of another group that I forgot about. I did know, but I didn't know
which
until
is?
You said it. The Guess Who.
Oh, okay.
The Guess Who, they do,
I did not know that.
No
right.
Time Left
right.
For
Oh,
you.
No Time. Okay, all right,
these
now
eyes,
I know.
No Sugar Tonight. And he told a little story about each song.
Oh, great.
Because he wrote a lot of them. And then they would break into the song, and it was just like, oh, my God. It was just so much fun.
Oh,
so much
that's
fun. It was
awesome.
Just them. And I mean, he's 80 years old.
Oh my God. Oh my God. I was going to ask you how old.
He's 80 years old.
I was going to ask you how old.
He just rocked the place. At the end, he finished it out with taking care of business.
Okay.
You know, but he had a little story. The one about the one where he stutters in the song, Ain't Seen Nothing Yet.
Oh,
his brother had that impediment. And
but baby. Oh, maybe I should sing that at karaoke.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
Maybe you should sing it at karaoke.
No, we know Linda's not going to get up and sing it.
Oh, that's awesome that you did that.
Yeah, it was
that.
A lot of fun. So he closed out with Taking Care of Business, and everybody was on their feet.
Who are we going to go see this later in June?
Journey. Def Leppard and the
Miller
Band.
Def Leppard is my favorite.
God. Me too.
I cannot wait.
Never had anybody to go with until now.
Oh, I love Def Leppard.
Yes,
Def Leppard, me and my friend
Journey,
Susie.
Journey, the lead singer of that, sounds exactly like Steve Perry.
I know.
It's unbelievable. You close your eyes like the Neil Diamond thing and it sounds just like him.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, so it's going to be great.
Steve Perry, where's he at?
Steve Perry, he left the
band.
He's
got his own, they had a fight or something, right?
They had a falling out. He came back and then something happened. He said, if you do that, I'm never coming back. And he never came back. But they found this guy on YouTube.
Oh my God.
On
See? YouTube.
YouTube
is good.
YouTube is
Speaking
great.
Of YouTube, people.
Oh, here she goes. Listen up,
just
everybody.
Just saying.
Listen up.
You can find, you have YouTube on your television. So if you're watching this on your little tiny phone or you're watching this on Facebook, which is fine, or you watch it on the computer, that's fine. But if you go to your Fire Stick or your Roku, whatever TV you have, and you go on the YouTube app and you look up Strong Island TV, we will be there and you can watch this. It's actually a television show. Yeah. So I'm just saying.
Just saying.
Yeah, because like 12,000 people asked me about that this week. All right, so listen, what day is it? There's a day for everything,
Linda.
Let's
hear it. Let's hear it, Monica.
There's a lot today, so you might not be able to take it all in.
Okay, I'll try.
March 21st is International Color Day.
Oh.
International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. That's a good one. National Crunchy Taco Day.
Oh, yum.
World Puppetry Day.
Oh.
National Memory Day. National Memory Day.
Oh, that's a good one.
World Vermouth Day.
Ooh.
National French Bread Day.
Yum.
Did I say Poetry Day?
No, not
National
yet.
Poetry Day.
Okay.
National Single Parent Day. Okay. National Slytherin Pride Day. The Slytherin, what is that?
I don't know.
International Day of Forests. National Down Syndrome Day. Good
Aww,
one.
That's
International
good one.
Fragrance Day. This Ooh. Is my favorite one, though.
What?
National Common Courtesy Day.
Oh, that's a great one.
And Tiramisu Day.
Oh, oh. That is like one of my that most is. Favorite desserts. Oh,
that is. That is.
Yum.
I know. So happy Tiramisu Day, Linda.
Happy Tiramisu Day, Monica.
So, we have a new segment. Today, we have a new segment called Fun Facts.
Oh, goody.
It's going to be very good.
Okay.
I love that little intro.
That's very cute.
So, I found this fact.
Okay.
And we're just kind of going to go. Did you know, Linda,
what?
That you are 10 times more likely to get bitten by a New Yorker than get bitten by a shark? You are 10 times more likely to get bitten by a New Yorker than you are to get bitten by a shark.
Oh,
now let's
okay.
just talk about that for a second.
How do we talk about that?
I don't know. Like, I, and you know what the funniest thing was? When I first read that, I was like, I believe that. I didn't even question that fact whatsoever. I thought, you know what? That is absolutely the truth.
Oh, my God. So New Yorkers are biting now?
They're biting.
They're biting.
So, okay. And you know, what I did was I said, well, here's,
you
I thought that
living.
I should give our audience some things not to say or do in New York or to New Yorkers to get bitten.
Okay.
So okay. Here's some things that you probably shouldn't say. Like if you're going to come visit here, you're going to go to a show, whatever. Or you don't do these things or say these things in New York. So don't come here and tell us the bagels back in wherever you live are just as good as the ones in
oh,
New York.
Oh, well, that's an absolute falsehood.
Do not do that.
Because we're known
Somebody
for that.
Somebody will 100 million percent bite you.
Well, we're known for bagels. That's what.
Don't. It's whenever you not. Come, like, I have a lot of people that visit it. Because once I moved here, people thought, they realized that it was a destination that they could come and visit. And then I'm also a very good tour guide. So, you know, the first it's thing they no say way. Is when I come to visit, let's go straight to Times Square.
Wow.
Or I want to climb the Statue of Liberty. Now, I'm just going to tell you right now, you could come and visit and I will drive you around. I will do whatever. I am not taking you to the Statue of Liberty.
Well, first of all, you wouldn't drive them there, Monica. You got to take the ferry over, number one.
I will drive them to the Battery Park and I will say, here is how you do this. And I will wait for you on the other end.
You could have waited.
Because let me tell you, I've done the Statue of Liberty a couple times and it is not fun.
I did it once.
Okay, it is not fun. I do not enjoy it. So don't ask me to do that.
Yeah, I did it once in the third grade.
And don't say, oh, my friend lives in New York, Brooklyn, Long Island. Do you know her? All the time.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I don't. No. I mean, 13 million people live on Long Island.
Yeah.
And more than that live in New York City. So there's a pretty good chance that I do not know your friend. However, you never know.
Maybe okay. They're just trying to make conversation.
No,
you got to bite them for that?
No. Yes.
Jeez.
Houston Street is not pronounced Houston Street.
Oh, well, yeah, that's, yeah.
And don't call 6th Avenue the Avenue of the Americas. Just don't do that. Just
okay.
House it. Now, I realize that in other parts of the country, the word Houston is Houston, like Houston, Texas. Right. I get it.
Right.
But here it is not. Yeah. It is Houston Street.
Well, there you go.
On escalators, do not stand at the top or the bottom of a busy escalator. There are others behind you. People do this all the time, and it's downright dangerous. Keep moving. Walk up and down the escalator. Don't just, like, get on the escalator at the bottom and then just stand there. Or stand there, like, two abreast. If you're going to stand there, just stand, like, so that people can get around you. Just do that. You will get bitten. I mean, you will get bitten. If you're walking, this is a good one too. If you need to answer your phone, look at a map, talking to your friend on a sidewalk, outside of a doorway, anywhere in general, there are people moving in a certain direction, stand to the side. Do not stand in the middle of the sidewalk. Just do not do it. Do not stand in the middle of a doorway. If you're entering a door or a train or an elevator or any kind of an entrance for that matter, mm-hmm. Let the people coming out come out first.
Absolutely. Well, yeah.
This happened to me at the Detroit airport.
Of course
the other
it
day.
Did. Of course it did.
I was standing there and there was like 6 people and the door opens and these people are, I'm like, what are you doing? Like, let the people out first. Okay, this is a general rule. I mean, honestly, if you do that in the train, people will just push you down.
Yeah, people are always in a rush, yeah. You know.
And you know what? Never be afraid to ask a New Yorker for help or directions. Like, when I came here, everybody was like, oh, New Yorkers. I'm like, listen, everybody was great.
Yeah.
But you know what? If you treat everybody like they're great, then they're going to be great.
Right.
But everybody will give you directions. We love helping people.
Right.
And the other thing I thought was interesting is that, oh, I know what I was going to say. We're very happy here. Mm-hmm. However, there's a misconception that New Yorkers walk with their heads down because they're not friendly. That is not the truth. The true story is that we're walking with our heads down so that we do not trip on the sidewalk. I'm just telling you this from experience. When I first moved here, I literally fell on the sidewalk 25 times because I was not paying attention.
Okay.
Because the sidewalks are like this. It's terrible. Okay. So just don't think that they're ignoring you. It's just that we're just trying not to fall down. And if you're around and a local gives you an invitation or a suggestion or somewhere to go or something to do, just go there. Just believe them and go where they say they're going to go. Like, if they say, oh, you know what? There's a great art show here. Just go there. You will never regret it because we know what we're talking about when it comes to fabulous things. Okay, so never turn it down. Unless you're invited by some guy to look at purses.
Yeah, well, that's a different
down an alley in a warehouse somewhere. Don't do that.
Yeah,
or someone says they're going to take your headshots for free. Don't do that either.
We don't do that.
Come on. So, you know, do that. No. So anyway, all right, we're going to go. So that's that. So those are some tips for you on how not to get bit in New York City. So don't get bit.
Other things that,
we're going to go to a quick commercial, so I just want you to ponder that till we get back. It'll be like, you know, a couple of minutes. Ponder what I said, and, you know, these are some things just not to get bit.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Arthur Lee, founder, CEO, and inventor of LifeVac, a simple rescue device that can save a child's life in a choking emergency. All these people were saved with LifeVac.
People may not realize that on average, 14 people a day die from choking-related incidents. Every 5 days, one of those is a child.
As simple as place, push, pull.
To learn more, please visit lifevac.net.
All right. Is everybody having a good time tonight or what? That's what I thought.
Bye.
Okay, we're back. Okay, we've literally been laughing about getting bitten the whole entire time.
Well, because I mean, it's like there are other things that can happen besides getting bitten.
But getting bitten is pretty bad.
Well, being stabbed or shot too is something else, but being bitten is
okay. So, listen. Okay, so about a month ago, Miss Linda here has informed me that she was her guilty pleasure show is Married at First Sight.
Well, no, let's give a little background.
Well, not a lot, but I just got sucked right into it.
No. All I wanted to say was that I was perusing Netflix for something to watch, and I was like, what is this show? And this thing comes up, Married at First Sight. I'm like, what is this? Like in the back of my mind, I said, I think I've heard of this. Let me just see what this is all about.
Right. So what is the premise of the show?
Okay, well, these people, they actually go through this whole screening process because they want to find their mate, you know, for life.
So their soulmate.
Their soulmate, whatever. You know, they want to get married, basically.
Yes, yes.
And they're all different ages. Like, some of them are really young. I was like, you're so young. Well, why do you want such a rush to get married? But they have never met this person, basically.
Until they are at...
Well, no. They go through the screening process, and then they find that person. They think that they're compatible.
Right.
With.
Well, the experts do. The experts do. Yeah.
And they come up to them, and they say, all right, you're getting married in 2 weeks. Now, they've never met this person.
Right.
So they're going on faith that these experts know what they're talking about.
And they literally go through a wedding, and they do not meet each other until they are standing in front of the minister.
Right.
Okay. That's insane.
It is insane. But you know what? You know when you start watching a show and it's bad, but you just got to see it through?
Well, I had to because now I'm on season 9. Okay. I started at season 1. She started the later season.
I started
the
later
season. So I haven't seen
the
later ones, but the first ones, I was like, what is going on right now? And so they follow them. So they follow them on their honeymoon. And they follow them through, then they come back, then they live together, right? Well, and it's all about, so they have 6 weeks.
Eight weeks. Yeah.
To decide whether they're going to stay together. Now, they are actually married.
Yeah, they are.
So
it's a legal and binding marriage.
A legal and binding marriage. So if they decide at the end of that 8 weeks that they're not going to stay together, they have to go through the actual divorce or annul or whatever it is process.
Yes.
So now it's tricky. Some of these people should not get married at all.
You want to know something? Back it up a little bit and then you.
No.
Back it up a little
bit. I got
it. Because years ago, what did they do? There were marriages that were arranged marriages. Do you know? I mean.
Now. Let me just give you a little something that you might not know about.
Oh, hit me. Come on.
My parents. Okay, so I grew up in a church that is very religious. Well, it's a really religious church. And I grew up in an apostolic Christian church. And in that church, they believe that the man, if the man wants to get married, he asks God to send him a bride. And God sends him the bride. And then he finds her. And then he asks her minister for her hand in marriage. The minister asks the woman. The woman prays about it, says yes or no. The minister goes back to the guy. They probably are, I don't know, maybe 3 months, and they get married. So it's really basically the same concept as that.
So you're
they did meet before.
Your parents?
My parents. And so my dad was stationed in San Antonio, Texas at Fort Sam. And my mom and a bunch of her girlfriends from the church went down there to do singing and stuff at Fort Sam. And my dad saw her, and they got, that's exactly how they got married.
Wow. And how long were they married for?
They were married till my mom passed away when I was 21.
Wow.
They were married 30 some years.
Wow, that's amazing.
And then my dad got remarried again, and it was did exactly the same thing.
Look at that. Wow.
So,
interesting.
I mean, most of my family on both sides that are in the church have been married that way. A lot of my cousins and everything. So,
I did not know
there's
that.
A lot to be said for that. So, I have a lot of hope.
Yeah, I mean,
I have hope that God really does know what's best for you.
Right.
I think that we just have free will, so we can mess that up pretty bad. So, and yeah, and the re and that segues into our segment for this week for Fabulous Places. So our fabulous place for this week is San Antonio, Texas, which is my second favorite place in the world. Okay. I love San Antonio, Texas. I started, we went down there when I was 13. My dad took us down there. We went to Breckenridge Park. We rode horses. And I'm obsessed with horses. That's a whole story for another day. So I loved San Antonio. I love San Antonio, Texas. My parents had a house down in Zapata, Texas, which is down by Laredo. They had, they were winter Texans, which was, instead of, you know, how people go to Florida in the winter, they went to Texas in the winter.
Oh.
So there's a bunch of their church group went down there, and we loved it so much. So Ernie and I started going down there, went down there, but we would always stop in San Antonio because I am in love with San Antonio.
Where in Texas is it situated?
San Antonio is like in the middle.
In the middle, yeah. Okay.
So we're going to I'm going to show a little video. It's like a 5-minute video about San Antonio because I want you to see everything. There is so much to do in San Antonio. So if you're looking for a good vacation spot, or it's great for families too. There's a lot of stuff to do for families. So we're going to show this video and then we'll talk about it a little bit.
Between the Mexican border and the Texan capital, Austin, sits historic San Antonio. It is the second most populated city in the Lone Star State and one of America's top travel destinations. San Antonio sprung up around 18th century bell towers of the Spanish missions. Today, the city's popular riverwalk connects these and many other iconic local attractions. Walk in the footsteps of the heroes of the Texas Revolution. Enjoy a festive atmosphere and experience the Latin culture. To give your feet a rest, cruise around in a river taxi or hop on and off vintage buses and trolleys. Linger on cafe terraces to try Tex-Mex or European food in between rides. A must-see is the Alamo. Once a modest Franciscan mission, and now a symbol of patriotism and defiance. In 1836, it became a fortress manned by a few hundred volunteers who bravely tried to hold back an invading army of thousands of Mexicans. They didn't die in vain. The Texans won independence that same year, shouting, "Remember the Alamo!" The nearby Institute of Texan Cultures takes you even further back in time. See how America's first peoples lived and learn why the state has attracted immigrants from all over the globe ever since. Step inside the simple dwellings to catch a glimpse of early life in the Southwest. Catch the river taxi to the former 19th century brewery that is now the San Antonio Museum of Art. This impressive building houses everything from the Egyptian goddess Sekhmet and other ancient statues to depictions of local history on canvas. Back in the city center, there is always something going on in bustling Market Square. Listen to a heartfelt song, browse the stalls, or simply soak up the atmosphere. Take a short detour to the botanical gardens, with plants flourishing in the dry Texan desert. A far more lush experience is a stroll in the nearby Japanese tea gardens with its amazing stone structures and the Jingu Tea House. This exotic attraction, just north of downtown in Breckenridge Park, is an oasis in this otherwise arid corner of the Southwest. In the same park is the Witte Museum. Let the children play before browsing the paintings and relics of San Antonio's past. Your passport to adventure is the nearby San Antonio Zoo. Good for some exciting wildlife encounters. Just a half hour drive from here, the residents in the Natural Bridge Wildlife Ranch have it made. The prairie and savanna animals here get to roam free within the park's boundaries. You can even feed some of the animals out of your hand during a self-drive safari. On a hot summer's day, there is nothing cooler than descending into the Natural Bridge Caverns just down the road. Follow the guide to a subterranean landscape of dripping stalactites and cathedral-like rock formations. Outside, the playground for kids and adults is something for the truly brave. Find your way back to the Riverwalk and explore La Vaida. Visit the craft markets around the old fountain or see a band in a riverside amphitheater. At the end of the day, ride the elevator to the top of the Tower of the Americas for a view you'll always remember. From the observation deck, San Antonio looks like a sparkling diamond under the night sky.
Video on the end of that beautiful San Antonio video, because Ernie literally made us go. He made us look for a place that was going to have karaoke. It started at 11 o'clock at night. And wow. It was in that. I'm not going to say where it was at, but it was in a really sketchy neighborhood. I'm telling you, like, we pulled up there and I was like, I don't know. And me and Susie and Tommy, our friends, were with us. And we had to drive down there and, oh my gosh. And we walked in there and we're like, oh, we were gonna die. Like, we were like, it was not good. It was bad. And we were laughing. And then he gets up there and sings Secret Asian Man and dances like a freaking nut. And we are like, oh, it was crazy.
Wherever you go, he'll find a place.
Wherever you go, listen, yeah, whatever. But San Antonio is just, it's just fantastic. And yeah, I love it down there. It's so, we go down there. We usually stay on the Riverwalk. This last time when we went, we did not, because my friends had a blue-green timeshare kind of thing. We stayed for a few days, and then we went down and stayed down on the Riverwalk. But the hotels are right there on the Riverwalk, and you go out the back, and you're just right there, and there's all the restaurants, and all. We go to Dick's Last Resort. You ever been to Dick's Last Resort where they make fun of you? Very fun.
No, it's on my list. I want to go.
So
next time you go, let us
yes,
know.
Yes, next time we go, you have to go with us, because we just had a great time. And there's so much more to do there than just those things. I mean, you know, there's a lot of historical stuff, but if you don't like that, there's so much to do. There's carriage rides. It's just a fantastic
city. When was the first time you went there?
Oh, my gosh. When I was 13.
Because that's where your father was.
Yeah, he was stationed in the Army. But then it was a long time between when Ernie and I started going back, and we just fell in love with that. We've watched that city grow, and it is just, it's a wonderful, wonderful city. So we're going to go to a quick commercial, and then there's something else I have to talk to you about what I found in San Antonio.
Me llaman Don Pablo, y hace más de 20 años me enamoré de una colombiana. Viajé a su país y conocí un estilo de café muy distinto, muy especial. Ahora tostamos cafés excelentes, con alturas y microclimas diferentes, resultado en una taza muy compleja y muy rica. Un sabor nuevo en el mundo. Fue un éxito. And I even got to keep the girl.
Hi, I'm Gretchen Rossi.
And I'm Arthur Lee, the creator of LifeVac.
We're here today to announce that to date, LifeVac has saved hundreds of lives of people who almost died due to choking.
People may not realize that on average, 14 people a day die from choking-related incidents. Every 5 days, one of those lives is a child. That's why I created LifeVac.
And as a new mom, and from housewife to housewife, I felt compelled to share with you the discovery of this life-saving device.
LifeVac is a simple-to-use airway clearance device. Just place, push, and pull to save a life.
And it costs less than it would take to fill up your car with a tank of gas. Imagine being able to save a life for less than $70.
To learn more, please visit lifevac.net.
That's LifeVac.net.
Please, don't allow one of your loved ones to become the victim of a choking accident.
Okay, we're back. I love that LifeVac. Love that thing. Every time I see
that
commercial.
I know.
Okay. So when I was in Texas, when I was in San Antonio, one of the first times when Ernie and I were there together, we were on the Riverwalk and we were in the Hilton, and there was a shop that sold blown glass. Now, I really had not been into blown glass at all before that. A little bit, not a lot. I mean, I always thought it was great. And we walk in this shop, and it was called Garcia Art Glass. And I just couldn't believe the stuff that they were doing in that shop. So I loved it. I loved it. And I bought my first piece of glass there, and the first piece of glass looked just like this right here. Somewhere. Here it is. This is called Crackle Glass. So I bought this vase, had it shipped home. They were wonderful. Mm-hmm. I had this vase for 6 years. Mm-hmm. Okay. It sat there. It was just in pristine condition.
It's a beautiful color.
Until one day.
Yes.
I was vacuuming.
Yes.
And I knocked it over onto the ground. And it shattered into a million pieces.
Oh.
Ernie was standing right there. Thank God it was not Ernie that did that. Because that would have just been, I don't know what would have happened to him. Anyway. I called Miss Jeannie Garcia and her group, and I said what a terrible thing that had happened. I showed them a picture of what I had bought, and they made me another one.
Oh wow, that's awesome.
Okay, it's not exactly the same, but it's pretty close. It's got lime green inside, which is my favorite color.
Yes,
and it's got a blue rim. Now all the stuff that they do is hand blown. Okay.
Oh, nice.
I then started getting into art glass, and I love Garcia art glass. I made a little video about Garcia art glass. I want to show you that, and then we're going to talk about a little bit about collecting art glass and what glass in general, blown glass, is all about. So let's show that video of Garcia art glass. At the beginning of that is a couple pictures of mine, and there's one picture of me the last time that I went to San Antonio to Garcia Art Glass. I got to meet Jeannie, and her sister came in while we were watching the demonstration, and I was so excited. So there's a picture of me with the two of them. Like, I'm never usually starstruck.
I was just gonna say you were starstruck,
and I was beyond myself.
I would have loved to see you.
I was
starstruck.
Beyond myself. So we'll watch that video. You can see it, and then we'll talk about it. It's really cool. It's really cool how they do it.
Okay.
My name is Jeannie Garcia. and I'm the president of Garcia Art Glass. They start by looking at my design, and then they lay out the colors on a piece of steel. They're laid out in granular form, it's called frit, and then they go into the glory hole, get it hot, and make a sheet out of that, because they melt all those little granules together. And then Gerardo takes his gather of clear glass, he calipers it to the size of the circumference of that sheet, and then he rolls through it and picks it up. And of course, all that color gets laid out by my sister looking at the sheet, the design sheet. And then she puts that down and gets really involved in the making.
He uses the mold, obviously, to shape it, but he wants to distribute the clear glass evenly throughout. He'll allow the piece to go down, he'll allow gravity to pull the piece down, and you'll also see how important teamwork and coordination is in what we do. Platter has to have a hole in the center because it's part of an installation that requires the metal tube to go through the center of it. So we have to prepare it to be ready for this chandelier. I'm gathering a little bit of clear glass that I'm going to shape and take to him just so he can put a little lip around that opening. The punty is a little bit of clear glass at the end of a solid pipe. They have to transfer that piece from the blowpipe over to another so they can work on the open end of it, and that's what he's doing there. Absolutely. We have a very short window of time to work with the glass, so you have to just move quickly and take advantage of the heat. You can see that Michael is helping him carry that piece over, and Edgar is distributing heat to the front end so that he can help him open that piece using the heat. So now Gerardo has gone to the front end of the piece, and he's working it from this side so he can get a view of that lip and how he wants to open it. ¿Ya es la última?
Approach to chandeliers is entirely different from the Venetian approach of chandelier making, but I kind of think of the chandelier as an extension of heaven, something coming through the ceiling. You wonder what's behind it, what's going on in the heavens that could produce something so beautiful. So I try to use, you know, I don't use sad or drab colors. I use very exciting and energetic colors, and try to create a sense of whimsy and try to do something that the client will enjoy for years to come. This chandelier that we've got right here in our studio was made for the Edwards residence. We've got it all assembled, and it was really made to mimic some of the things they've got going on in their game room. They sent me concept boards, and I got to design around their art and their collection of pinball machines. And you know, when I think of pinball machines, I think of kind of retro and 50s and, you know, hip, cool stuff from that era. So I made these little retro toy guns that are shooting out this way, and they kind of resemble, it's just out of my imagination, what the era was around that time. Anyway, this is a really fun piece. It's best seen from right below, and it's really whimsical, and it's a great representation of of what we do here, and it's a lot of fun.
Isn't that wonderful?
Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. That is
amazing. She is so wonderful.
Stuff.
So the last trip, last year when I went down, I got this piece. This is my new piece.
Beautiful.
I am in love.
I love the colors.
I mean, look at the lip. Like, you know, they blow this and then they pull this around. And it's just, it's exquisite. It's just, her stuff is exquisite. Look at the colors in there.
I know. I love the colors.
And everything, you know, everything is one of a kind. It's just,
it's beautiful.
You can see it here. It's gorgeous. It's gorgeous.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
And their stuff is not cost prohibitive. I mean, it's not inexpensive, but. It is. And then these are just a couple of smaller pieces. These are actually not from Garcia. These are the first pieces I ever got. I think I got these in upstate New York one time. So anyway, if you're ever in San Antonio, you can go down there. They're right there by La Vallita, and they have a new shop. They're wonderful. They do demonstrations. You can go in there. Mm-hmm. However, there's two things. I have a guilty pleasure, and my guilty pleasure show is called Blown Away on Netflix.
I just started watching it.
So if you are interested at all in glass and how they do it, go look at that show. I think there's, three or four seasons?
Four seasons.
They just did the fourth season. It is really, really, really amazing.
It's a competition.
Yeah, it's a competition, and it is just fantastic
amazing,
show. So now that's called. And then also, if you're here in this area where we are, or you're down in Ohio, wherever you are, Corning, New York is the famous museum, Corning Museum of Glass. So
yes, you have mentioned that.
I'm actually a member of that, and it is so wonderful down there. It's a great family trip too. Now they've got a hotel attached to it. The whole town of Corning is really a wonderful town. There's all kinds of galleries and shops and just all kinds of things to do. And the Museum of Glass is just wonderful. So you can go through the whole history of glass. It's just a wonderful, wonderful time. You can take classes there. You can get a membership. And it is a wonderful, wonderful time. The last season, if you just watched that last season of Blown Away, they gave a membership, a residency to the girl that won that.
I just started watching.
Oh, shoot.
So don't give it away.
No girl won that. Sorry, I messed that up. There wasn't a girl.
I just started.
I think it was a guy just with long hair.
Now you're giving it away.
No, you don't know. You will not. You won't remember by
that. So now I feel bad I didn't go to the one when we went to Italy a couple of years ago in Venice, the Murano Glass.
The guy from the Murano Glass Factory was on that show.
Yeah, well, there was a girl this week
on
this season that was talking about it.
It is fascinating. Well, and then there's another one called The Great Pottery Throwdown, which I really like too. I really don't I don't collect pottery, but I love the pottery. I love that show too. Well, I love any of the competition
I should have went
shows.
To it.
Really, really great.
I was with guys who just wanted to eat.
Freaking guys.
Well, we're in Italy. They have the best food.
All right,
you know?
But
so
there's
like,
other
you
things.
You want to go to Glassblower, or do we want to go get some nice, authentic Italian food?
Well
their stomachs won out.
That's a really difficult decision.
Well, the food was really good. But now I really, if I ever go back to Venice, I don't know if I...
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, we're going to go to a quick commercial, and then we're going to come back and talk about Linda's collection, and we're going to talk a little bit about why people collect things, how you should display your collections, and
well,
some other
an
stuff.
There's an art to that, huh? Mm.
There is a little bit of an art to that.
I can't wait to hear.
All right. We'll be right back.
In the heart of Bowling Green, Ohio, lies a treasure trove of wonders, a place where the joy of giving comes to life. Welcome to Poppy Lane Gifts and Decor, your ultimate destination for gifts that speak from a heart. Nestled in the heart of our community, Poppy Lane is more than just a store. It's a treasure trove of beauty and inspiration, carefully curated to bring joy and charm into your life and home. From the perfect piece to complete your cozy nook, to the ideal gift that says, I thought of you, every item in our collection tells a story. A story of craftsmanship, love, and a touch of magic. And because we believe in supporting local talent, Poppy Lane proudly features exclusive pieces from the area's finest artisans. When you shop with us, you're not just buying a gift, you're investing in the community, nurturing creativity, and celebrating local craftsmanship. So, whether you're celebrating a milestone, searching for that perfect piece to add to your collection, or simply treating yourself just because, Poppy Lane Gifts and Decor is your destination for the extraordinary. Visit us in the Woodland Mall on Main Street or shop online at poppylanegiftsanddecor.com. Poppy Lane Gifts and Decor, where every gift begins with a story.
And we're back! We're back!
You certainly are.
We're back. Okay. So we are now going to talk about Linda's collection. Now, yesterday, I thought I knew a lot about Linda. So we were over there yesterday, and I said, we were talking about collecting. I was telling her about the glass, and she said, I collect penguins. I'm like, you do what? She's like, I collect penguins.
I can't believe you didn't know that.
But I had no idea you collected penguins. I love penguins. They're so cute.
They're very cute, and it's he's a classy bird.
He is a classy bird.
Looks like he's in a little tuxedo.
He does. So I have a surprise for you, because when you told me that you collected penguins, the immediate thing, there's a video that I literally have watched 100 times, and I'm going to show it to you because it's very funny.
Goodness.
So Bobby put this little tiny short surprise video on for Linda.
Okay.
Yeah.
But explain this, but it's come to that. This is odd. Of all the questions we had, the one that came up most often was ask Benedict to say the word penguin. What is this about?
Well, apparently I got it wrong repeatedly in the documentary. It wasn't a documentary about said animal. It was a documentary about, I think, about the South Pacific in general. And now I'm completely terrified of the word. I don't go near it.
Well, no, because I know, here's the thing. I thought, I'm sure they're making it up, but we actually looked
at this
documentary.
Oh, good.
So the documentary is called... Good. The documentaries are called Strange Islands. The first one you sort of get away with, and then after that you lose all sense of what you're doing. Let's have a look. Listen carefully.
And the last thing you might expect to see here is penguins. These are Fiordland crested penguins, named after this corner of South New Zealand. So why are these woodlands so attractive to penguins? A freshwater stream through the forest makes a handy highway for a parent penguin heading home from a fishing trip.
The funny thing is, you don't do this in isolation. You have a team of, you know, natural history experts based in Bristol, funded by you, the taxpaying public. It's not just me sitting there in a booth going, I think I know how to say penguin. I'll say penguins. It's mortifying. But there are other people who should take some
you
flack,
and
including
booth
my producer.
You in a bottle of vodka.
Well, yeah. But no one at the end of the thing, could we just try the word penguin again?
Maybe. Maybe they just gave up. I don't know.
But then what I love is, in the way that life is, how special that Benedict is now starring as a wolf in this film. So can you say it now?
Well, I've had a word with Disney. I need to check that I have said it correctly in the film.
Penguin.
Only you, Monica,
is that not
find
the funniest thing
like that?
But listen, I have been watching, like, I've literally watched this that clip like 12,000 times. And I love Benedict Cumberbatch. And
so
I thought it was so funny.
I love him.
So here you say penguin, and it was everything I could do yesterday not to tell you about this, because I was laughing.
What was he saying? Penguin?
Penguin.
Penguin.
Penguin. Penguin. So, all right, so tell me how you started collecting penguins.
Well, you know what? I was thinking about it before. I'm trying to remember the first penguin I ever got, and I think it's this little guy here. Because I started collecting these little, can you reach it?
Oh,
for
yeah.
Me?
This little baby?
The little baby
one. Oh, my gosh,
one.
He's so
I started,
cute.
Somebody got me into these little glass figurines, and
don't
I said, oh,
them.
I want to get one.
Don't drop them.
Hey, let me see. Let me grab my little guy. And I said, I wanted to get a glass figurine, and I saw this penguin, and I'm like, oh, I have to get him.
I love
they
it.
They are so cute. And he was the first one I ever got. So I guess after seeing him, I don't know, I just started getting into them. And over the years, I just, people
guy.
Have been buying
Is
them
Is this the new
me.
One you
That's
just got?
That's the new one I just
oh,
bought.
Oh, you got that baby.
I just bought him yesterday. He's so cute. Look at him. Look at him. They're just so cute.
So
and
cute.
These
the
guys are
one,
awesome.
Somebody bought me this in my family for Christmas or something. I don't know. This one. And then my mother bought me the Lennox penguin.
You know, penguin.
Penguin.
Penguin. Penguin.
And my son bought me the wooden one.
Love the wooden
last
one.
Last Christmas. Yeah. A little rustic penguin. He's a little rustic guy. He's so cute. But, I mean, my Christmas tree at Christmas time is full of penguins. Sparkly penguins.
And how, like all the birthday cakes that I've ever gotten you for your birthday, I've never done a penguin birthday cake. Like, that would have been the most fun thing ever. I could have made little strawberries with penguins on them.
Well,
I mean, I just,
know,
there's so much
I don't
potential
know. I
for
just,
that.
I think he's just the cutest bird. He can't fly.
He's very
the
cute.
Bird that can't fly.
He's
but
very
do you see?
Cute.
Have you seen when they walk? They waddle. And
send
just,
us pictures of your collection.
And did you ever see of March of the Penguins?
Yes, it's so cute.
It's the best.
Now
movie.
We have to watch the movie Penguins with Benedict
oh
Cumberbatch.
Oh my God! I love those penguins.
Oh my
I love
God.
Those penguins.
But you know, I wanted to talk a couple minutes about why people collect
oh,
things.
Oh yes.
Like I've been always.
What did you
I
find
collect
out?
Things. You collect things. We, you know. I think that it says, you know, a lot of people, there's five main motivations for collecting. There's selfish purposes.
Right.
Preservation.
Mm-hmm.
Restoration. History. A sense of continuity as a financial investment and as a form of addiction. And the one thing I said is a collector, a hoarder. And it says, in contrast to people with hoarding problems, collectors typically keep their possessions well organized. And each item differs from other items to form interesting and often valuable groupings, which I thought was interesting because it's like you don't have hundreds of penguins. I don't have hundreds of, like, I literally have maybe 7 pieces of glass. Like, not that I'm not a hoarder, because I think I might be, but we won't go into that right now. But, I mean, you know, a lot of people are big collectors.
Yes.
Well, not that there's anything wrong with that.
No, no.
I mean,
I you know what? Let me ask you something. These glass, the ones you have, these pieces, do you have them? You know, on
yeah.
Display?
Well, I have. Yeah, I have like wall cabinets, like in there.
You do,
they're
right?
In there, yeah,
yeah
by themselves, like they're
right.
By themselves. Yeah,
that's where or I had my little penguins
right.
And my Lennox.
Right.
Like I don't have my whole house. Like you don't walk
right.
In my house and be like, oh my God, right. There's penguins everywhere.
Right now, I did
it's
that
just,
with lighthouses. And it was a little bit, it was overboard.
It's a little
and
much,
I,
right?
When I redid my house, I just stopped. I got rid of, like, I, yeah.
I know, but these are, well, that was
I
would definitely
like,
put on display.
Well, we
those
have really
beautiful.
Small houses. Like,
yeah,
I have
an
original, like, if anything is out of order, and all there's something always out of order, I'm just saying.
Just saying.
Just saying.
Is there, always something but is there an order. Etiquette to it that you should not?
There really isn't. I mean,
I
you
mean,
know,
display it
it's
like
whatever
an entire...
makes you happy. I did a little bit of reading about the best way to stage collections. I mean, if you've got a collection of plates, hang them on the wall.
Right, right.
You know, if you've got a collection, group them together. Like if you're doing pottery, group your collection together so it's a collection.
Right. Right.
You know,
don't
if you
just scatter it.
Yeah. Like if
yeah.
You have it all
gotcha.
Over your house and there really isn't any rhyme or reason.
Right.
Like you, if you're collecting something and it's really important to you and you love that thing, when people walk in, they're going to be drawn to that. They're going to be like, oh my gosh, look at your collection.
Yeah.
It's not going to be just a bunch of clutter.
Yeah, that makes
of
sense.
Of things all over the place. So make right. it make sense.
Right.
Make your collection make sense. I mean, what I saw somebody had, like, they collected ice picks, and they had made a whole wall collection of ice picks, which I thought was really cool. You know, if
oh
you collect
goodness.
Books, like, it's just, I thought it was very, very, very great. You know, you can light it. You can, I like the idea of putting collections together.
Right.
You know,
right.
And then listen, you're either going to have a smaller collection, you're going to have a collection of something, or you're going to be like way over the top. I mean, we know some way over the top people.
Yeah,
with the,
I did know somebody was way over the top with that stuff.
Yeah.
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 She had her whole house adorned with her collection. It was like too yeah. much. You walked in, you were like, oh my God, where am
right.
I? You know, it was
right.
a little
right.
much.
Right.
It was like you were in another dimension.
Right.
Of,
well,
you know.
And you know what? Listen, I'm a more person, okay? Mm-hmm. In my brain, more is better, and that's not always the way that it should be. More is not always better, but you know, if it makes you happy, do what makes you happy.
Of course, absolutely. I aspire to that too.
You know, I mean,
totally
I just
agree.
I have a lot of stuff. I end up collecting a lot of stuff. Like, I'll do Halloween, and then I have to have every Halloween thing. If I'm gonna do jewelry, I gotta have every jewelry thing. Like, it's just ridiculous. That is not a collection. That is just
that's a little much.
That's insanity.
Yeah.
Is
what's
what
the
is.
Definition of insanity?
Yeah. So, are you going overboard with your collection, or are you just collecting, or are you being a hoarder? Let us know.
Yeah.
If you need help, we're happy to help you. Anyway, thanks for watching. We had a great
yes.
time tonight. We're a little bit over, and
yeah.
It was really fun. We talked about a lot of things today.
Hey, who's going to be on
next week? We're going to have Renee Escorza from Escorza's Restaurant. He is moved here from Mexico. He's an amazing Mexican chef. We want to talk to him about how he came up in the business, and he is a wonderful guy, and we love him, and he's going to be here next week.
To talk about his restaurant.
To talk about the restaurant. And then the week after, I think we're having the senior ladies
oh,
on.
Oh, that'll be fun. That'll be
yeah.
fun.
So yeah, so we'll start having some guests now and then, and it'll be fun. If you have suggestions for guests, let's do it.
Absolutely.
So
that's
it was fun.
Yeah.
Bye. Have
Bye,
a
everybody.
Wonderful, fabulous
have
week.
Have a fabulous
we will see
week.
You next week.
Yes.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, penguin.